Hello, welcome to another lecture on deep learning. So remember that we're using optimization to compute the optimum set of parameters for a deep learning model. What we haven't discussed so far is for models that are more complicated than a linear regression or a logistic regression, how these parameters are optimized. So for an optimizer, we need to compute gradients. So similar to as before, we will use stochastic gradient descent methods, which require the gradient. Now, computing the gradient of a deep neural network that has multiple hidden layers is not trivial. And the backpropagation algorithm is the solution that will give us the gradient. Let's look at how the backpropagation works. As an example that we will use to illustrate the backpropagation algorithm, we will focus on a multi-layer perceptron that has a single hidden layer. But this could really be any neural network. To make it a little bit more interesting, we will also add L2 regularization, so shrinkage, on the weights of this neural network. So it's a network that has an input x that takes our input features to compute a hidden layer, and then use this hidden layer to compute the output value. Backpropagation consists of two steps. The first one is the forward propagation, where we go ahead and compute all the variables and intermediate variables of a neural network. And the second step will be the backward propagation. Let's start with the forward propagation. So for this network, we start out by computing, given the input vector x, which is d-dimensional, a intermediate variable z, which is given by a linear function in x. So we take x, multiply it by a weight matrix, which is h times d. So it takes our d-dimensional x, and by multiplying with w1, we get the h-dimensional vector z. Now realize that z doesn't appear in this neural network, so it's an intermediate variable, which then is plugged into our nonlinear activation function phi. So this is a placeholder for any of the activation functions that we have seen to compute the hidden layer variable h that is depicted here. So because phi is an element-wise operation, h has the same dimension as z. And then we use our h and multiply it by a second weight vector. So it's the parameter of the second layer, w2, which is q times h, to compute an output layer. And we assume now that we are in a regression setting, so we don't apply, we don't change the value range of the output layer. So the output layer can produce any values in R. Realize that we do not include bias terms here, but this is not really a restriction because we can always introduce a 1 in X and then add another weight that represents the bias term. Now, given our output vector O and our label, we can use those to compute the loss function, which is L. So L takes O and our label Y and computes an error, which is a loss. And as we also said that we want to do L2 regularization on our weights, What we actually have to do is, because our weights are not given by a vector but by a matrix, we actually have to use the Frobenius norm, which gives us the equivalent. The Frobenius norm is basically the L2 norm after the flattened matrix. It's basically taking a matrix which is H times Q and just stretching it out into an H times Q vector, and then computing the L2 norm of that. And we also have our hyperparameter lambda that adjusts the strength of the shrinkage. So a high lambda would give us smaller entries of weights and thus a higher loss. So it would basically result in a smaller Frobenius norm of the weight matrices in return for a smaller loss. And a lambda of zero would mean that we would try to fit our labels as good as possible. So now we're almost done with our forward pass. The last thing that we have to do is to compute our final objective function J, which is given by the sum of L and S. So of the loss and our shrinkage. And subjective is also called the regularized loss. Now this forward pass, the computations involved can very well be visualized using a computational graph. So in a computational graph, we have several types of nodes. We have squares and circles. Squares denote variables, and circles denote functions that take a variable or any number of variables and produce an output. For the squares, we have white squares and blue shaded squares. And the shaded squares are parameters that are learnable or trainable, and the white squares are either the input or intermediate variables that are just being computed, so that are not trainable. And the way to read such a computational graph is generally from the lower left, where we have our input vector x. Then we come to the multiplication operation, so we multiply it by the parameter w1 to compute the intermediate variable z, which then in turn is plugged into our nonlinearity to compute h, the hidden layer, which then in turn in the second layer is multiplied with the second weight matrix to compute the output. And the output is then finally compared with the labels to get our individual loss L. And now L is our model loss, which is then our unregularized model loss, which is then combined with S. And S is given, again, computed by taking the weight matrices and computing the Frobenius norms of these, squared sum of the entries, so the sum of the Frobenius norm of the squared Frobenius norm of W1 and the squared Frobenius norm of W2. These are summed up to compute the regularization term, and the regularization term is computed to our unregularized loss to compute the regularized loss or objective function J. So this is what the forward pass does. It computes all of these intermediate variables and outputs and stores them, because they will be needed again in the backward pass. So backpropagation refers to the method of calculating the gradient of the neural network parameters. Remember, the neural network parameters in this one are the trainable ones, so that's W1 and W2, the weights of the two layers in our neural network example. In our forward pass, we calculate and store all the intermediate variables that are needed to compute the objective function and that are related to each layer. And then in the backward pass, we can compute the gradient of the parameters in the order from the output to the input. So in the forward pass, we started with the inputs and computed everything on the way to the output. Now we start from the output and take gradients until we derive at the gradients of the weights, and we use the chain rule of calculus to do so. So just remember how the chain rule works. So say y is a function of a vector u, and u in turn is a function of the vector x, where u is m-dimensional and x is n-dimensional. Then we can compute the partial derivative of y with an entry of x using the partial derivatives of y with the entries in u times the partial derivative of u with respect to x. And we do that for each entry in u and sum these products up. So first, so we always have a product for all the respective entries in u, and then we have a reduction by summing over all the entries of u, of all the entries of the intermediate variable. Now more generally, if we're talking about tensors in arbitrary neural networks. So remember, matrices and vectors are special cases of tensors. Vectors are tensors of first order. Matrices are second order tensors, but there can also be higher order tensors in more advanced neural networks that we will study in this course. So say a tensor Y is computed as a function of a tensor X. And this tensor Y is in turn used to be plugged into a function G to compute another tensor Z. So that's basically what we always do in neural networks when we layer these functions. Then really what we have computed is Z as a function of X, where this function is now a composite of G and F. And the goal of the backpropagation algorithm is basically to resolve these composite functions. Again, a deep neural network is a composite of functions over the layers, where each layer is a function, and compute the gradient of the objective function with respect to our weights, which are somewhere deep down in the neural network. And so we have to use the chain rule. So X, Y, and Z can be arbitrarily sized tensors. Then we can use the chain rule to compute the derivative of Z with respect to X. And this is done using the derivatives with respect to the intermediate variable. Basically, if y is the intermediate variable, then we take the derivative of z with respect to the intermediate tensor y, and the derivative of y with respect to x. And then we take these two. Now, similar to the vector form, because y has now multiple entries, there is now this derivative tensor, where so both of these tensors here So this is a tensor, this is a tensor, will be consisting of all the different partials. So the partials for the entries of C with respect to the entries of Y, and here the partials of the entries of Y with respect to the entries of X. And these two tensors will have some dimensions in common that correspond to the indices of the entries in Y. And the prod operation, we introduce this to simplify our notation, such as this works for arbitrarily sized tensors. So it's exactly this summing up the product. So we basically have the corresponding entries of Y. We multiply the derivative here with the corresponding derivative here. And we do that for all the indices of the tensor Y and sum over all of these indices. And this is what this operation prod does. So for vectors, this is the simple matrix-matrix multiplication. But for higher order tensors, this is a little bit more complicated. Now, let's look at our example and do the backward pass. The goal is to compute the gradients of the objective function with respect to our two weight matrices, W1 and W2. And in backpropagation, we use the chain rule. Realize that we cannot directly just apply the chain rule once, but in order to get from here to here, we will actually have to go over multiple hoops. We do that by using the chain rule over and over again, basically starting from here to compute all the derivatives with respect to the intermediate variables, which then in turn will be used to compute the derivative of the next intermediate variables until we derive or arrive at the weights. So remember the objective J equals L plus S. So the regularized loss is given by the loss plus the shrinkage. Then, because it's just the sum of the two, the derivative of the regularized loss with respect to the loss is 1. And the derivative of the regularized loss with the shrinkage is also 1. So these are quite simple. But these again will then be needed to compute the next derivatives as we go along the computational graph. So the next thing is to compute the derivative of the objective, the regularized loss with respect to the output layer of the neural network. And the output of the neural network is connected to the regularized loss via the unregularized loss. And thus, what we need to do is to apply the chain rule. So we compute the derivative of J with respect to L, which we are already done, that's a 1. And the derivative of L with respect to O, because the prod operation now only operates over a single entry here. This is just a product of 1 with the derivative of L with respect to O. So what we're left with is just the derivative of L with respect to O. And finally, the next step is to go this way. So we have gone against the arrows backwards up to here. Next is to also go against this arrow here to compute the derivative of J with respect to W. And one term that is needed in order to do so is the derivative of S with respect to W, and that is just lambda W1 and lambda W2 for W1 and W2 respectively. So the next thing that we can compute is the gradient of J with respect to W2, which are the model parameters that are closest to here that we can reach with the fewest hops in the graph. And if you apply the chain rule, then D of J with respect to W2 is given by prod of D of J with WO, which we've already computed, and D of O with respect to W2, plus, which we have not yet computed, the prod of D of J with respect to DS, and the reason for that is that we have the sum here. So we have these two paths here converging, where the W2 is involved. So the other part is D of J with respect to DS. Again, this is a 1, and DS DW2, which we have just computed as lambda W2. So if you multiply that out, this becomes lambda W2. And the first part is DJ DO, which we already have computed. And the derivative of the output with respect to W2 equals H transpose, because O is computed as the product of W2 and H. So if we take the derivative of this term here with respect to W2, we're left with H transpose according to our rules for matrix and vector derivatives. Now we can compute the gradients with respect to the hidden layer outputs. So the next step is to go here. So to compute the gradient of DJ with respect to H, and this is given by the term that we just computed and the derivative of O with respect to H. So this is the intermediate variable, and this is the derivative of the intermediate variable again. How does O depend on H? Well, O is given by W2 times H. So if we take the derivative with respect to H, it's using the same rule as before. First we took the derivative with respect to W2, we were left with H transpose. Now we're taking the derivative with respect to H, so we're left with W2 transpose times this term here. And now we can go one step further to compute the derivative of J with respect to Z, because we have already computed everything up to here. Now, because this part is element-wise, this will also use element-wise operations. So again, we apply the chain rule by saying that DJ DZ is DJ with respect to DA, which is the intermediate variable. This derivative we've already computed. And now we can take the derivative of this with respect to Z. And this is DJ DH, so the part that we have computed before. And then we have our Hadamard product for the element-wise operation. And we have to take the derivative of the nonlinearity and plug Z into that derivative. And then we have basically computed all the derivatives up to here and here. So we can now compute the derivatives with respect to W1. So DJ W1 is given by the product of DJ DZ, the part that we have just computed, and then DZ DW1. So Z is given by W1 times X, so the derivative of this will be X transpose, plus prod of DJ DS and DS DW1, which will be lambda times W1, because this is a 1 here, and this is lambda times W1. So we have DJ DZ times X transpose plus lambda W1 as our gradient of J with respect to W1. Now we have computed the gradient with respect to W1 and W2, so with respect to all the model parameters, and we're done with our backward propagation pass. We have seen that forward and backward pass are interdependent because during the forward pass, all the intermediate calculations that are computed there will be again used in the backward pass. Therefore, we have to store them and cache them. As a result, backpropagation actually needs quite a bit of memory because it has to compute all of these intermediate terms and cannot just throw them out. But in order to compute efficiently the gradient, it has to keep them around until the gradient is computed. That is also a reason why backpropagation requires significantly more memory than if we just want to do a prediction with our neural network. So making a prediction is what's called inferencing in the neural network world. So inferencing requires much less memory than backpropagation. Why is that the case? Because whenever we go along the computational graph from the input towards the output, we can throw out all the intermediate calculations as soon as we're done with them. However, for backpropagation, we have to cache them, so we have to keep them around and store them. Even more so, another reason why that also requires more memory is because we're typically not just doing stochastic gradient descent with individual examples, but we're doing mini-batch stochastic gradient descent. So we're using multiple examples at once, using mini-batches in order to make the computations more efficient. And thus, we also need to store additional intermediate values because each example in our mini-batch will result in computation of hidden layer and in all these intermediate variables. The amount of memory needed scales linearly in the size of the mini batch. And it's important because neural networks are typically computed on GPUs, graphics cards, that this actually means that the graphics card memory is actually used sort of within such a backpropagation operation. So let's summarize. Forward propagation is the part where we compute, starting with the input, all the intermediate steps towards the output. This is required for the backward pass. So the backpropagation algorithm consists of both of these steps, and they're interrelated because in order to compute the gradient in the backward pass using the chain rule, we need we get all of these terms that we have computed in the forward pass. So we have to cache them. And training, therefore, requires significantly more memory and storage than just making a prediction with a neural network. And with this, I want to say thank you and goodbye for today. See you next time. Bye-bye.